Welcome to the Skip and Shannon Undisputed Podcast. I'm Joy Taylor. You can catch us Monday through Friday at 9:30 a.m. Eastern, 6:30 Pacific on FS1. Here's what this podcast is all about. It's an unscripted, unfiltered, undisputed version of the day's show, and there is a lot to get into in today's podcast. Shannon claims the Warriors would have lost yesterday without Kevin Durant because Harrison Barnes is not giving you 32 points. Skip calls out Paul George for being a poor man's LeBron James and offers harsh criticism for not taking the last shot. Our man Chris Broussard checks in to break down why, even after last night's blowout, Russell Westbrook is still the regular season MVP over James Harden. Skip, Shannon, and I react to the tragedy faced by Isaiah Thomas and his choice to play in yesterday's Game 1 against the Bulls. Finally, Kenyon Martin, former teammate of Carmelo Anthony, helps us understand the problems with the New York Knicks and if Melo will stay in the Big Apple. Skip and Shannon, how was your Easter?
Happy Easter to both of you.
Happy Easter.
You late.
Yeah. I'm late?
Yeah.
I thought this was like a company holiday too, right?
No.
No? I think it is.
Wish me a greeting on the actual day.
Yeah.
Just like New Year's. Don't be saying no Happy New Year's. Here we are, April. Oh, I hadn't seen you. Happy New Year.
I'm Grumpy Shannon. Don't tell me Happy New Year.
Thank you.
And don't tell me Happy Easter the day after. How about that?
Fine. Happy Easter.
By the way, thank you very much. And Ernestine gave me a silly Easter card that had a silly joke in it. So I texted the silly joke to our man Wayne.
Mm-hmm.
We just saw in the open. And he actually thought it was funny. But it's, what kind of music does the Easter Bunny like?
Hip-hop.
Look at
Wayne
Ernest.
Thought it was hilarious.
That's
because
very cute.
Wayne has a little kid in him that likes Easter.
That's a good little joke.
Did you think Saturday's game was funny?
The Rockets blew out the Thunder in Game 1 last night. James Harden had 37 points and 9 assists in the win. Russell Westbrook was just 6 of 23 from the floor and had a playoff career worst 9 turnovers in the loss. We're joined by Chris Broussard. Welcome, Chris. Good morning.
Thank you. Great to be here.
We need some wisdom on this.
What did you learn last night?
Well, first of all, let me cut off Shannon before he even goes here.
What?
I voted for Russell Westbrook for MVP.
You want that vote back now?
This is what I want to say. What happened yesterday, what happens over the next 2 or 3 months, however long the playoffs are, has no bearing on what happened in the regular season. The MVP is a regular season award. It's not who did what last year in the finals. It's not who does what in this year's playoffs or the finals. If LeBron leads Cleveland to the championship, there will be people saying, see, he should have won the MVP. No, it's about the regular season. And Russell Westbrook had the best regular season. Now, that said, yesterday, I mean, Harden, he was terrific.
He was?
Oh, my gosh. He controlled the tempo. He only had 2 turnovers. Mm. He fed his teammates. Mm. He scored at will. Skip.
Well,
he was fantastic. Yeah. He hit every big shot. I mean, the dude was great.
Ask Cantor, how was he?
Oh, my gosh.
How was he from 3,
yes.
Chris? Help me out.
I don't care if he missed a few. I saw him hit the 2. That's all right.
So
I saw him hit the 2 back to back.
Okay, it was
on one side, then on the other side.
Chris, they were up 20.
Because of him, exactly. Why were they up 20? Because of him. The dude was a maestro yesterday.
Yeah,
Harden is a bad boy. I also learned that he's got much more help, you know, and whether it was, you know, his shooter, Patrick Beverley got hot, kind of worked, you know, made up for Eric Gordon not being hot.
Yes.
But Beverly, this is a pretty decent defensive team in Houston. Mm-hmm. For a Mike D'Antoni team, they have some good individual defenders, namely Beverly. And, you know, and Ariza's a very good defender too. And they have some other ones, Capella, Montrezl Harrell. And Beverly, there's nothing worse than a little quick, strong dude that can hound you. That's a pest.
Yeah.
And he won't shut down Russell Westbrook, but he'll just bother him.
Just annoying.
You hate, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, you hate that. So,
by the way, they have some history.
They got a history too, yeah. Everybody was wondering, was Westbrook gonna tear his meniscus on that play when Beverly was hiding? So, look, I thought this would be a good series, and it still may, but I picked Houston in 7.
Houston at 7.
That's what I was thinking. And look, we've seen this happen before where there's a blowout in game 1 or even 2. And then it comes and it's a good series. So I'm not going to give up on it being a good series. 5. But it might be because Houston's tough. They're just a better team. And he's got a lot more help than Russell Westbrook and a perfect system for his team.
Russell can keep them alive. but it's over in 5. Mm. You know that. I know that, Chris. And you're going to wish
you
had...
I don't know for sure.
You're going to wish you had that vote back. Here's the thing.
You didn't hear a word I said.
Unless Russell goes for 35, 12, and 12, they have no chance. They got pounded. They're the best rebounding team in the NBA. They're a plus 6, and they got out-rebounded by 15. They got doubled up on the offensive end. And when you get Taj Gibson give you 1 rebound and 5 points, you get Oladipo 1 for 12 with 6 points, and then Steven Adams got that $100 million, that extension, and went back to New Zealand. They ain't seen him. They hadn't seen him since he signed that contract extension in October, because Skip talked about, well, he only had this many. He should be ashamed of himself. He's 7 foot tall, 270 pounds, and he lets Russell Westbrook out-rebound him. That's unacceptable.
The whole year he did.
Yes.
And last night he did again.
Yes.
11 to 5.
Look, Steven Adams should thank Westbrook and Durant for that contract. People acting like he was about to be some all-star, some great player because of last year. No, he had 2 of the top 5 players in the world with him who draw all the attention. He's a solid role player.
Hard last year.
He's a role player.
And he was an agitator and a villain, and it
helped. It's easier to be that when you got 2 stars.
He hadn't been the same since Draymond kicked him. You think that might have something to do with it? Ever since Draymond kicked him, Skip, he ain't been the same.
I think $100 million had something to do with it, because he's resting on his laurels now. But I don't even recognize. I don't even know who he is anymore.
He's a different guy. Yeah. But
Skip, before you go, but here's the thing, Chris. Do you believe that Ryan Anderson and Trevor Ariza going to score 8 points between the 2 of them again?
No, you're right. They didn't have good.
Eric Gordon didn't play good.
But Beverly's not going to go for 21 either.
No.
Most likely. That was his playoff career high.
Career high. So let's just say he gets 10. But at some point in time, you know Lou Williams and Eric Gordon are going to explode. And when they do, Skip,
they're a better team.
So I want to thank both of you for making Russell Westbrook's MVP case so loudly here, because last night screamed that he is MVP, because he doesn't have nearly the supporting cast that James Harden has in Houston. He doesn't even have the perfect system. I just quoted you. Yep. The perfect system for all of his attributes. Which
he does, Skip.
Huh? No.
Shoot as much as you want, whenever you want. That's a perfect system.
Well, that'll work.
Westbrook was in D'Antoni's system, it'd be lights out too. D'Antoni, when he has the right personnel, man,
now, Russell would have to listen to how we're going to do this, and he would have to buy into how we're going to attack this. But he could, and I agree with you.
He's a great pass. He's a very good pass.
Once he figures that he might average 15 assists in D'Antoni's system with all those snipers. But what disappointed me the most, the reason this game got so hard to watch in the third quarter, is that Russell's inferior supporting cast didn't come to play last night. Like, at least you can show up and show some physicality and some fight. Right. And they just didn't fight. They got rocked on the backboards, in the paint, points in the paint, second chance points. It was devastating. What a team that no longer has Dwight Howard. You know, it's like, right. I felt like Dwight was out there, right? Clint Capella's doing this to you? Did you see Ryan Anderson, a 3-point shooter, had 12 rebounds? Patrick Beverly, he's listed at 6'1". I stood next to him. He's about 6 feet. Yeah. And this is a man who bounced around the Russian leagues and the Greek leagues and the D League. And he, as I told Shannon, I know him. He cares so much about every second. He cherishes every second on an NBA playoff floor. And he gave them guts and energy. And he was in Russ's jock from the start. And then I thought the turning point of the game was, you want to talk about manning up? He got bone-rocked by that pick with 8:31 left in the third quarter. And did he get up and whine about it and complain? Nope, he got up doing this. Like, he got me, and I'm going to get him back. And he came right back down, boom, 3, and came right back down, boom, 3, and the game broke open because it was a 2-point game at that point. So I give it up to Patrick Beverly for showing guts and energy and fight that I didn't see from any of the Thunder. Taj Gibson. He gets 1 rebound in 20 minutes. How does that happen?
It can't happen.
Yeah.
To have any chance. They're the number 1 rebounding team. And when you get out rebounded by the Houston Rockets by the tune of 15, you get doubled up on the offensive glass 14 to 7, and you're going to lose.
Russell was attacking the glass with ferocity. I mean, there were no little fake rebounds yesterday. He was going up there.
He got real rebounds. Yep. And here's the scariest part. by far the second best offensive player on Oklahoma City's roster comes off the bench. His name is Enes Kanter.
Yep.
He can play little to no defense, especially if he gets stuck in pick and rolls against James Harden. And he just got embarrassed three times. And guess what? He got yanked and played a grand total of 16 minutes last night when he needs to play 30 minutes because Billy Donovan said, I can't leave him out there in pick and rolls. We're going to have to go back to the drawing board and fix our pick and roll or we got no chance.
And that's
because they were playing the threes as hard as they could play them. Houston didn't shoot very well from three by their standards, but the paint is like open season. Just go to the rack.
You saw why Russell's MVP. They needed every single triple-double he gave them. They needed him to get a triple-double every night. That's why they were 33-9 with him in triple-doubles.
His sidekick, the guy 14, who rides 26 shotgun
Oladipo,
he gave him like triple zeros
last night, right?
1 for 12? Yeah. Are you kidding? And 0 for 6 from 3? They can't win like that.
They don't have much. The playoffs is when you see what you have, your supporting cast. And they're not – their PER, the other four starters for Oklahoma City – their PER during the regular season was the worst among a supporting cast in the league.
And Russell's was number one.
Yeah.
But Skip, guys, this is not earth-shattering news. They've been this way all year long.
That's why we're saying Russ was the MVP.
No, but James Harden.
He did it without the help.
Hold on.
Harden has some help.
I love it now. See, you doing what Skip does.
What?
They win ball game, they play well. All of a sudden they lose, he got no help.
He doesn't have help. They won those games. They're good role players. Steven Adams, Taj Gibson, Oladipo, they are what they are. But they're not Lou Williams. They're not Eric Gordon.
Role player.
Hold on. Eric Gordon was an all-star caliber player when healthy.
He just could never stay healthy.
He's going to be the sixth man of the year. He's still young, though.
Yeah, I know.
He's still young. He just has never been able to stay healthy. Now he's healthy.
Shannon,
Lou Williams.
Shannon.
Great sixth man.
After last night, are you willing to admit finally that Russell Westbrook
is James
MVP?
Harden.
Harden cooked him. Harden did cook him last night. And he may have a better series. But that doesn't negate what happened over the 82.
How are you going to have a better? I told you what was going to happen.
LeBron's going to be the best player in the playoffs, probably. That doesn't mean he should have got MVP.
You remember in 95 when they gave Hakeem Olajuwon's MVP to David Robinson? What did he do to it? Cooked it.
A regular season award.
Cooked it.
Who was James Harden cooking? It's like I can cook in the microwave. I cook every night in the microwave.
I can't believe, though, Skip, you don't think Harden was great. What was not great about Harden yesterday?
At one point, he was 1 for 8 from three.
Okay
that's not
That doesn't mean good. That's all.
No, I thought he was
But then
really
he hit
them
step back three.
Yes. And he was getting to the hole at will.
What about the great Andre Roberson,
who's a great defender.
Yeah.
Right?
Robertson had his career.
He took him at will to the basket.
To the basket.
He didn't take him. It was either Steven Adams
or
Enes Kanter.
Or in the first half, he was taking Robertson.
Well, he takes everybody.
He was finishing.
Harden got to the. Oh, what? Hey, that last one he got
he's
on Kanter.
He's finishing, and where's like, Steven Adams?
Oh,
where
is he? All right, that's fair, but.
He's over there collecting his check.
He was bad.
What exactly are you cooking sideways?
He
like
just
this?
Cooking something.
I feel like everything that's in your bowl is on the ground.
That's what James Harden. James
you
Harden
hold the bowl
hey,
like
you
this.
Didn't see James Harden hit that three.
I mean, I don't cook, but I don't think it's this way.
Sideways.
I think it's this way.
Wait, you're like reeling.
No, hey.
You're reeling.
What are you
reeling
doing?
I cannot cook Joy.
Like some really
cooked,
like frosting.
Joy ought to be ashamed of herself.
You got to play your game in the playoffs. Oklahoma City led the NBA in rebounding this season.
I challenge you to a cook-off.
Rebounded by 15.
I challenge you to a cook-off.
What, scoop out some hummus and put
don't
it on
worry
the plate.
About that.
Maybe that's what you're whipping sideways. No mercy. Thanks for listening, guys. Before we get to the next topic, here's Shannon with a message from ZipRecruiter.
Thanks, Joy. Hiring can be a real pain, and it can be difficult to know where to post your job and to find the best candidates. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites. And now you can with ZipRecruiter.com. You can post your positions to over 200 job sites, including social media networks like Facebook and Twitter, all with a single click. It's that easy. Find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post once and watch your qualified candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. No juggling emails or calls to your office. Nobody has time for that. Quickly screen candidates, rate them, and hire them fast and in person. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by the most powerful companies and thousands of small and medium-sized businesses. Right now, listeners of our podcast can post jobs on ZipRecruiter for free by going to ZipRecruiter.com/undisputed. That's ZipRecruiter.com/undisputed.
Thanks. One more time, our listeners can try it for free by going to ZipRecruiter.com/undisputed. Now back to the show. No mercy. The Cavs held on to beat the Pacers in Game 1 on Saturday. LeBron James had a game-high 32 points in the win. The Pacers were down by one with under 10 seconds left when Paul George passed to C.J. Miles. Then Miles missed a potential game-winning jumper at the buzzer. After the game, George talked about the final possession. Let's take a listen.
I gave it up, you know, to soften him up and try to get it back. I talked to C.J. about it. Situations like that, I got to get the last shot. C.J., you know, took it upon himself. I'm confident with all my guys taking shots. That's not the issue. But in that situation right there, I got to get that.
Obviously, we were trying to get a play, a situation for Paul to be able to get the shot to win the game. They ran a double team twice. They had a foul to get the first time. Then they ran and did it again the second time. By the time it got to me, it was under four. It was going down. So I felt like I had to make a play to get for us to get a shot off. I thought I had a good look at it. Left it a little short.
Skip, does Paul George have a point that he should have taken the last shot?
He has absolutely 0 point.
Whoa!
He was merely trying to deflect the blame that he deserves every last bit of. And him trying to deflect the blame onto C.J. Miles, I guarantee you, will not resonate well with the rest of his teammates, who will lose even more respect for a Paul George that I've said many, many times on this show, right here on Undisputed, 9:30 to noon Eastern time, right?
Yep.
I have said that Paul George is a star, but never a superstar, because he is not that guy who wants to take that shot that will win that game. So in that way, he is a poor man's LeBron James. And by the way, the real James, the real king, opened the door for Paul George to actually make a shot that mattered, because the real king missed a free throw, a big free throw with 1:16 left in the game that seemed to be hovering over this game, that 1 point, because that's what was dangling at the end of the game. And then LeBron came down and missed the clinching three-point shot with 20 seconds left. And I've told you, LeBron falls back in love with the three. And then
he only shot three of them,
yeah,
Skip.
He made his first two, and he says, oh, I got this. No, you don't got this. And all of a sudden, they had the ball going the other way. So incredibly, twice in the last 20 seconds, Paul George turned into LeBron James late in games by turning down two shots and turning down two chances to drive the lane and get to at least the free throw line, if not the basket, for some dunk or lay-in shot.
Wasn't going to happen.
You know, wasn't going to happen. So, of course, I need to remind you that two Sundays back, there was a double overtime game that was played in this very building, Indiana versus Cleveland. Remember that one?
Yes, I do.
52 LeBron minutes to dispatch Paul George. And he dispatched him because at the end of the first overtime, what happened? Paul George stepped to the free throw line with 2 seconds left and a chance to win the game by making both of his free throws. And he's a 90% regular season free throw shooter. He can really make his free throws. And what happened on the first one, LeShannon?
What happened?
He missed it.
He missed it?
He missed it. It lipped out. It was vintage classic Paul George, the star who's not a superstar.
He missed another one in the fourth quarter, too.
Okay, so fine. So that's the guy. And trust me on this. That was weighing heavily on his psyche on each of the last two plays, because there were two chances here. Let's go back to 20 seconds left. Inbounds to Paul George, top of the key. He turns, and who does he see in his face? Is LeBron guarding him? No! J.R. Smith is guarding Paul George. Where is the king?
Jay Sweezy got it.
What?
Jay Sweezy got
it. You cannot defend this. Why didn't LeBron James man up and take Paul George? It's best player versus best player. It's size versus size.
Talk about Paul George in the shot. Don't worry about what LeBron was doing.
But you got to understand the shock of looking up and seeing 6'6" J.R. Smith in front of you when you're 6'9" Paul George. And you're thinking, go. But no, he wasn't. I'm thinking that at home. Attack him. Just attack him. And guess what? The first time, he did attack him. And he gets into the lane. And he's got a step on J.R. Smith, and he decides at the last second, wait a second, I'm going to give the ball up. Why don't you just rise up and shoot a mid-range jump shot, or just keep going? Because J.R. Smith is going to have to foul you, but you're going to have to go to the free throw line, stand by yourself with two chances to win the game. And he did not want to get back into that same scenario in which he had choked the couple Sundays back.
Yes.
So he gives the ball up on a dangerous, awkward cross-court pass to C.J. Miles, and Richard Jefferson is shocked by it and kind of overplays it, overcommits, and bumps into him. Right. But they have a foul to give. It's not a shooting foul.
Right.
So inbounds a second time to Paul George. Top of the key, he's got the ball. He turns to face J.R. Smith. Go! Just attack him. And he hesitates, and LeBron hesitates over here on C.J. Miles for a second and kind of indecisively, half-heartedly starts to come to double team. And then he's like, I can go. He's not going to move. I'm going to go double. And all of a sudden, Paul George says, I got to give the basketball up. And then he says after the game he wanted it back. No, he didn't want it back. And C.J. Miles, trust me, C.J. Miles, as soon as he got the second pass from Paul George, he's like, heck with you, man. If you're not going to shoot this, I'm just going to go shoot this. C.J. Miles can shoot threes.
Yeah.
He was a 41% three-point shooter.
12th in the NBA.
You know, that's pretty good.
Very good.
So maybe if he had more time to think about it, he should have just pulled up and shot a three. But they don't need a three. So he did what he's not accustomed to doing. He took two or three dribbles inside the three-point line and tries to shoot a mid-range pull-up jump shot. That's not going to work. That's not your shot.
And he's more of a catch and shoot as opposed to a dribble.
No, I got it. So you're asking him to do exactly what you don't want C.J. Miles to get forced into doing at the buzzer. And, of course, he missed it. And can you believe that your Cleveland Cavaliers dodged yet another bullet at home because they should have lost the game. They could have lost the game. Mm-hmm. And the Pacers could have a game two tonight to play with no pressure at all. You just have a free shot at Cleveland, where you'd be up 1-0 in the series. And instead, thanks to your star, Paul George, you're down 1-0. So none of it really mattered. And now all you're doing is just second-guessing
yourself.
How
many times have you seen Paul George in this situation? Indiana, they win a game in Miami. And what does LeBron do? He precisely goes right up to Indiana and take home court back. Mm. So that's what would have happened.
Oh, would have happened.
Would have, okay. But we didn't need that to happen.
Okay.
Skip.
How can you defend this?
Skip, Paul George made the right decision.
He didn't.
Skip, I keep telling you, it's never wrong to make the right play.
It's not Skip, the right play.
LeBron was in between because if you notice, LeBron was guarding Lance Stevenson. Mm-hmm. Lance Stevenson was under the basket. But LeBron's like, I'm not even worried about you. You self-check, Mr. I'm born ready. We already know you're going to goat it up anyway. So I'm not going to even really guard you. I'm going to split the difference between you because just in case Paul George tries to come to his right, I'm going to be ready. Mm. But guess what happens? He's dribbling the ball. Then all of a sudden, LeBron blitzed him. So now...
Blitzed him. He kind of half-heartedly sort of wandered over there.
He was in between, and then he rushes him. And he makes Paul George give the ball up. And that's what you want. Ty Lue said in the huddle, we are going to take the ball out of Paul George's hand. And we can live with whomever else willing to take the last shot and they hit it.
So help me out on this.
Okay.
Why wouldn't the best player on the planet, a Mount Rushmore player, say in the huddle, I want Paul George? It's his counterpart. They're both 6'9".
He has no counterparts in the NBA.
In this game, this is his counterpart. Is Paul George not the best player on the Pacers?
Yes.
A LeBron wannabe? Yes. Sure he is.
He wants to be the best Paul George he could possibly be. Mm-hmm. LeBron's counterparts are retired. Mm-hmm. They're the Jordans, the Kareems, the Wilts, Westons. Yeah. So those are LeBron's counterparts. He has no contemporary counterpart. Now, can I get back to my point?
Yep. No, you didn't answer the question. Why wouldn't LeBron want Paul George?
Skip.
He's the best defender on the
team. We don't get involved in that one-on-one, I'm guarding you, I'm a guard. That ain't what we do.
So it made more sense for J.R. Smith.
Because we're going to come with the trap.
You know, like, can you really trust J.R. to make the right play at the right time?
J.R., do not let him get to his right. Mm. Force him to his left. Mm. LeBron is coming with the blitz. We're going to make him give the ball up, and we can live with anybody else taking the last shot. Coach Belichick, I give you an example. You think Coach Belichick is a very good coach, don't you?
He's all right.
Okay, let me ask you a question.
He's got the best quarterback in the history of football. But
how many times does he let the opposing team's best player beat him? He says, if your second, third, fourth receiver can beat me, mm-hmm. I can live with that. Antonio Brown, you're not. Julio Jones, you're not. And that's what Ty Lue said. If C.J. Miles, you want to take that shot, have at it. Lance Stephenson, you want to take that shot? Have at it. But Skip, if you look at Paul George's resume, he's not the best at taking shots to go for the go-ahead. Mm-hmm. He's 0 for 12.
I got 0 for 13 in
the last in your last 20 seconds.
Yes.
I ain't want to go last 20 seconds because that's a lot of time, Joe. I'm going to kick it.
Actually, the final 10 seconds.
Yeah, 10 seconds.
Yeah.
I mean,
way to go, Paul.
So you feel you want him to take that with his resume.
You know what? I would much rather have Lance Stephenson take that shot. That's I told you before. I told you Friday. The only player on the Pacers who is not afraid of the king in his house is Lance Stephenson. Did he not come in and give them some energy and some shot making?
He did, Skip. But the thing is, here's the thing. Paul George wanted that. But the problem that I have with, and I get it, Paul, you wanted the shot. But you can't criticize your team publicly. You can't say you have confidence in your teammates and then criticize them for not giving the ball back to you. Skip, there have been times on third down or fourth downs I wanted the ball, but I believe that John made the right play because I was double-teamed. So I believe that Ed Rod could make a play. Granted, if...
By the way, that is why it's so hard to be a receiver in the National Football League, especially like Terrell Owens' problem. We had him on here recently.
Yeah.
But his problem was he loved basketball so much he wanted to be a basketball star also.
Right.
And in part, he loved basketball because you get to pick your shots. Like sometimes you got the ball in your hands and you could say, I'm going to choose to shoot this ball.
And
but in your role, again, I considered you incredibly clutch.
Yeah.
I want the ball in your hands, but I have to throw the ball in your hands. I have to choose to throw it in your hands or you can't make the play.
Right.
You don't have the option.
No. And you're totally dependent on the quarterback making the right read and says, okay, I can give him an opportunity to make a play. But if somebody's going to double team, if they're going to say, you know what, we refuse to let you throw it to this guy. Well, you got to go to your next option and believe that, hey, he can make this play. Well, Paul George, you got to have enough confidence in your teammate. And that's what LeBron does. LeBron says, I have the utmost confidence in all my teammates because I'll pass it to you, Darren Williams.
Even Darren Williams on his first night as a Cavalier.
It doesn't matter. It was his first night with the Cavs, but he'd been playing basketball for 20 years. So I have no problem with that, Skip. Yeah.
You want to talk about deer in headlights in the far corner? You're throwing it to me to shoot this? Wait, I don't want to shoot this. And he missed.
And did you see how efficient LeBron was? Mm-hmm. 32-14. Mm-hmm. I mean, just man, I'm so sick of these old ho-hum numbers of LeBron be throwing them. They be boring me to death. Mm-hmm. What are you doing scoring 32 points on?
I always ask you, what's he doing the last couple of minutes of the game? Well, he missed a huge free throw at 116, and then he missed the clinching three and left the door open for Paul George because can't walk through that door.
Exactly. He shut the door in his face.
Yeah. Can you believe this? The Indiana Pacers had LeBron on the ropes once again in his house. The LeBron team that went 23-23 over their last 46 games, who couldn't close games.
What did they do at home?
Couldn't close this game.
What did they do at home?
Well, they were good at home, but again, they should have lost at home to the Pacers two Sundays ago.
No, they shouldn't.
Yeah, they shouldn't. Come on.
Oh, Skip. But, I mean, think about it. J.R. Smith, at some point in time, J.R. is going to have to give us something. At some point, Richard Jefferson gave us, 1 for 3. He had 5 points. Kyle Korver had 2 points. But here's the dilemma that Ty Lue is going to face. And I know LeBron, he loves this lineup. He loves going himself, Kyrie, Channing Frye, Darren Williams, and Kyle Korver. But Skip, everybody puts Korver and Channing Frye in pick and roll. And they're so slow of foot, they can't defend. Now, if you're making shots, because what Channing is a stretch five. So he's going to pull your rim protector away from the rim. And now LeBron and like Kyrie gets to play downhill. But here's the problem. Skip, they're not guarding anyone. Neither one of these guys can guard a parked car with an Uzi. So now what do you got to do? He had to take Channing out. He had to take Korver out because they can't guard. They had a 10-point lead. And next thing you know, it's the Indiana's in the front. I'm like, hold on. You just had a 10-point lead with
they did.
And now you're down to how?
It's been happening for 3 months. Again and again and again, that scenario has happened. It happened in Chicago on that Friday night.
Yep.
Three Fridays ago.
Happened in Atlanta.
Happened in Atlanta.
Oh, by 26 to start the fourth.
Thank you very much. So nothing surprised me about that. But LeBron, again, was very fortunate because if LeBron had drawn the Heat in the first round, LeBron would have lost.
Skip.
If he had drawn the Bulls in the first round, LeBron would have lost. but he drew the one team he psychologically owns because its best player, the LeBron wannabe, the poor man's LeBron, is not even LeBron in the clutch. So they found one team. I don't think the Pacers play any better defense than the Cavs play. No. That's a big advantage for the Cavs.
But, I mean, when you really break it down, Skip, did anybody play a whole lot of
no.
whole lot of defense?
No.
I mean, everybody, they played, look at it. They gave up 108 points. Okay, Golden State gave up 109. The Celtics gave up 102 or 106. Nobody's really playing defense. Mm-hmm. The days of the 90 Knicks and the bad boy Pistons, Skip, those are a thing of the past. First of all, they're not going to let you play that brand of basketball anymore. Second of all, nobody wants to see that brand of basketball. They want to see you get up and down the court. They want the game to be free-flowing. And Skip, you need to get over the fact that LeBron's going to go to number 7.
Well, if he keeps getting these breaks and people keep handing it to him on a silver platter, you're right.
They play
Utah. I mean, they're going to sweep the Pacers.
You told me, I mean, LeBron, what was his record over the last 46 games? That's a big sample size, too, Joe. You know, a big old sample
size.
That's 56%.
56%. 23 and 23.
So they should be vulnerable. Everybody should be licking it chopped to get at.
What were the Cavs on the road this year? 20 and 21. And what did I tell you? It's been since 1978. That's almost 40 years.
Almost 40 years.
NBA champion with a losing road record. Wow.
And that 1978 Bullets team, led by Wes Unseld, Elvin Hayes, Bobby Damage, you remember they called him Mr. Clutch. Mm-hmm. He played, won a championship, too, also with the Milwaukee Bucks. Remember that, Skip?
Do I?
But anyway,
you're a lot older than I am, so we give you that.
So what?
I was just a little kid watching that. Go ahead.
You had a mustache and a full beard and everything back in 19...
But here's the mustache now.
But here's the thing, though,
Skip. I don't even shave.
Do you ever have a full beard?
No.
Let me ask you this, Skip. That team that went on to win the championship had a losing road record. Did any of them have a player of the caliber of one, King of Akron,
LeBron
James?
You just had to land that, huh?
Did anybody have
that? I'll give you that.
That's the
equalizer. That's why it's even more shameful that LeBron James' team was 20 and 21 on the road this year. Maybe LeBron's just getting old. Is that possible? He doesn't even want Paul George on the last sequence? Go guard the best, LeBron.
Well, I tell you what. I'm going to look and see what player in year 14 posts career highs in rebounds and assists. Mm. I'm going to be looking over the next 10 to 12 years if the Lord spare my life, because I want to see somebody average.
None of us felt the Pacers were going to beat them in this series, but it felt
Skip, I did not.
It was a mismatch.
It felt like a really huge blown opportunity.
It was just the worst.
But here's the thing, though, Skip. Everybody knows the game that normally the road team steals is game one.
Not always.
We saw what Utah did. We saw what the Bulls did. Mm-hmm. We saw what Milwaukee did. Yeah. But what does those teams have that the Cavaliers do have? Mm. They have one Mount Rushmore.
I gave him this until now. I have to add one last thing.
What is that?
One team in today's NBA still plays real live defense, and it's the San Antonio Spurs, who clamped down on Memphis the other night, down 26-13, and just suffocated the Memphis Grizzlies from that point on. They play the best defense by far.
Skip. Do the Grizzlies even average 100 points in the regular season again?
Well, it looked like they scored 30 in the first quarter.
Skip.
30 times
Think
4,
about
that's
it.
120.
Their best player, who's Mike Conley, has never made an all-star team.
I think it's Mark Gasol,
okay.
But go ahead.
But let's just say for the sake of argument. Yeah. Okay, their best player or their second best player, Mike Conley, has never made an all-star team.
Should have.
And has never been all Who are we going to make it over? No
mercy. Eighth-seeded Bulls beat the number one seed Celtics yesterday to take a 1-0 series lead. It was an emotional day for Isaiah Thomas, who played in the game just one day after his younger sister, Chyna, was killed in a car accident. Thomas scored 33 points. After the game, the coach and teammates talked about the emotional day.
He was incredible. He's an amazing, amazing player, amazing person. And, you know, days won't get easier for him, but he... you know, somehow plays like that. Listen, the perspective of it all, you know, hits you in a hard way. And I was, and not only proud of the effort, but the way they supported him. And, you know, again, I couldn't help but be inspired by his play.
This is hard. You know, this was difficult. And, you know, I felt like our guys, we really dealt with it the right way. But Isaiah is the one that I feel like dealt with it best. You know, we knew he was hurting. This is not easy, and we have a lot of respect for him.
I know it's tough for him. It says a lot about him. It says that he's a true competitor. I know tonight he was playing for his sister. He was playing for his family, and we appreciate that as teammates. And he's just an amazing basketball player, and even a better person. So I'm happy with the way he played tonight, and we just need to continue to fight for him.
Skip, what's your reaction to Isaiah Thomas playing yesterday?
Joy, Shannon, I have faced this dilemma again and again and again in my lengthy career. Should an athlete immediately play in, say, a big playoff game or a big golf tournament or tennis tournament immediately upon losing a loved one? And my view has always been the same. It's not my call. That's his or her call.
Correct.
Strictly up to the athlete on how the athlete is feeling, because I have no idea how Isaiah Thomas felt yesterday morning or at game time. I know he cried at the end of the shoot-around, sat on the bench for a while with Avery Bradley, completely understandable. He had tears in his eyes before tip-off. On his shoes, he wrote, you know, RIP little sis, and I love you, and various things on his shoes. So I don't know. So how do I translate that into how he played? My wife Ernestine and I went back and forth last night. She loves the NBA, and we were watching the game together, and she just couldn't believe that Isaiah chose to play. But Ernestine is extremely close with her sister. Her sister, in fact, moved out to LA with us because they just could not be separated. So I felt like she was projecting her love for her sister onto Isaiah. Not that he doesn't love his sister, but she's going to look at it very differently. God forbid, if she lost her sister, she would be devastated.
Correct.
And she's thinking, there's no way I could even imagine playing in a big basketball game. Some people would look at it that way, and others would say, no, maybe their family members all encourage them just to go ahead and play.
Right.
Sometimes there's a lengthy illness of, say, a parent, and the parent has a chance to tell the athlete, hey, if I don't make it until tomorrow and you've got your big game one of as the number one seed, don't you worry about me. I want you to play for me in the playoff game. So you got that sort of thing operating. But bottom line was, Isaiah chose to play, and I thought he played very well.
So did I.
All of his numbers across the board are a little better than his regular season numbers in every category. And were his teammates a little out of sync early because they were so upset for Isaiah? You could maybe make that case because they got pounded on the boards 53-36. They had lost second chance points by 8, so that was kind of the difference in the game. But you know what? In the end, the Bulls are just a little better than the Celtics to me. And in the fourth quarter, Jimmy Butler was the best player on the floor because he scored 15, and Isaiah still scored 12 in the fourth quarter, but it wasn't enough. So in the end, I have to say God bless him. As Brad Stevens said, it's not going to get any better for him as the days pass. And I assume he might have to make a quick trip or some kind of a trip to Seattle, maybe today, part tomorrow. Maybe he'll miss tomorrow. I don't have any idea. But in the end, that is his call.
I totally agree with you, Skip. And if he's comfortable playing, who am I to tell him what he should or shouldn't do? Me personally, I would already know what my brother and sister would want me to do.
I got it.
Now, my grandmother passed. Mm-hmm. I was already out of the league. But I already knew she would want me to play.
Okay.
Because she's going to say, what are you going to do? Get here, put me in the ground, go on and play that game. Mm-hmm. Skip, I had a situation in 1999. My nephew passed. My sister and my grandmother told my sister, don't call that boy until he practiced. She wouldn't call me. Now, my nephew passed. She didn't call to tell me.
How close were you with your nephew?
He had cerebral palsy.
Okay.
But my sister's my best friend. There's not a day that doesn't go by that we talk. Mm-hmm. And we talk about everything. Mm-hmm. So we're very close. But she didn't call me because she didn't want me that to be on my mind. But if something, and we've already talked about this, if there was an emergency going to take place, I'm going to play that game, and then I'm going to come home and take care of what I need to take care of. Skip, I thought he played well. I thought he played an unbelievable ball game, given the circumstances in which he was dealing with. Some people deal with emotion differently because I also equate it to, and this is totally different, to bringing in life. Mm-hmm. You know, say an athlete wife is about to give birth.
Yep.
If the couple have gone and already discussed this, says, okay, if I'm about to give birth and you're about to play a game, you play the game. If I'm about to give birth, you need to be there. So whatever they decide as a couple, Skip, I'm cool with it. I'm not going to tell him you should be there for the birth of your child. Oh, this is just a game. Life is much more important. That's not what I do. Whatever you decide, I'm going to support you 1,000%. If you choose to play, I'm all there for you. If you choose to be away, I 1,000% understand that also, Skip. But Jay Crowder, you had 9 points. Amir Johnson, you had 5 points. Isaiah Thomas did what he does. Fourth quarter, he shows up. He led the NBA in fourth quarter scoring at 10 points a game. He had 12. He had 33 points. He played an unbelievable ball game. But when you look, when you actually get down to the nuts and bolts of this, Skip, this is not a good matchup for the Celtics.
I agree.
And also, Danny Ainge is going to be kicking himself because what good is that first round pick going to do you in this playoff? You could have had Paul George. You could have had Jimmy Butler.
I don't know that for a fact, but you would think he could have opened that vault of picks and he could have had either one of them.
Because all these picks that you could possibly land, until LeBron gets old and decrepit.
Well, you said this the other day, and I agree with you. I think Danny's just looking at the bigger picture saying, I got to wait until the king gets old in the East. And I'd rather just build for the distant future by taking perhaps the best player in this draft if they hit the lottery, which they have the best chance of getting with the Nets pick.
Because, Skip, if you think about it, a team that's – we're going to talk about them later. Look at Portland. They got two unbelievable performances. Mm-hmm. But, Skip, but a team that's better than you, when they can go four deep, five deep, you're going to lose. Mm-hmm. How are you going to beat this team when you only got one player? Really, all you got is Isaiah Thomas. They still have D-Wade, who's a three-time champion. They have Rajon Rondo, who's been a champion, who's been an all-star player. Mm-hmm. And they got Jimmy Butler, who's ascending.
Yep.
So, really, you got one and they got three against your one.
Right. And, by the way, quick thought on Dwayne. He did look pretty bad because he can't get up
anymore.
Okay, so I know that was embarrassing, but his knees are just shot. They're close to bone on both sides. But I still would want him on my team because he had a couple of big steals. He stole the ball on that play.
Yep.
And he had a couple of big blocks. He's going to do little big things, and you just like having Dwayne Wade on your side in a big playoff game.
And he made a couple of big jumpers late in the fourth quarter.
He sure did.
But, Skip, I know some people are going to be critical of Isaiah Thomas saying, how could you play, you know, with this tragedy hanging over your head? Unless you know that individual, unless you know his family dichotomy, don't judge the man because you don't know. Just because that's what you would do.
Yeah.
Okay, if that's what you want to do, you want to be away because you couldn't focus, everybody's going to support
Got
that.
It.
But Isaiah Thomas felt that he needed to be, he didn't need to. He wanted to be there for the Celtics because I guess I'm putting my thoughts into him. I guess he's saying there's really nothing I can do. Now she's gone on to a better place.
Yep.
I'm going to play. And when the time is right, I'm going to fly to Seattle and pay my respects, bury my sister, and I'm going to be back to go play for the Celtics. I have no problem with whatever decision he would have decided to act upon. I can live with it either way.
And by the way, I don't think any of the three of us would have a problem if he'd said, I just can't play today, right?
None.
Of course not. But it's a personal matter. And like you said, people's family, you don't know what people's family situations are, what their family told him. Maybe they all encouraged him to stay there. You know, and he's unclear. His status is unclear for game 2. He may travel back to Seattle for his sister's
funeral. One of the best examples we have, Skip, is Brett Favre. Right. Brett Favre's dad died on a Sunday. He was playing a Monday night game. And Brett said, this is the best game that I've ever played in my professional career.
Well, it looked to me at times, because I was covering the Raiders, it looked like they were just watching, right?
There are like 3 throws that he made. He had no business throwing. And they had no business catching.
Right.
Wesley Walls and Javon Walker made 2 catches. Like, how did he do that? And
inspiring performance.
Yes, and he said that Irv would have wanted me to play.
Brad Stevens said it's his call and it should be whether he's going to play.
Absolutely.
So we'll find out Wednesday. No mercy. For the fourth straight year, the Knicks are not in the playoffs. On Friday, Phil Jackson had some strong criticism for his superstar, Carmelo Anthony. Let's take a listen.
We've not been able to win with him on the court at this time, and I think the direction with our team is that he is a player that would be better off somewhere else and using his talent somewhere where he can win or chase that championship. I've never criticized Carmelo. That's all supposition by papers or whatever, speculation by opinionated people. Holding the ball is not a criticism. That's what he does. That's pure fact. Is that a person, you know, person better be able to take that if they're going to be coached, or else they can't be part of this organization.
On Saturday, Michelle Roberts, the head of the players' union, released this statement. We voiced with the commissioner today our view on the inappropriate comments by Knicks president Phil Jackson. If players under contract cannot, under threat of league discipline, speak openly about their desire to be employed elsewhere, we expect management to adhere to the same standards. The door swings both ways when it comes to demonstrating loyalty and respect. We're joined now by former NBA All-Star Kenyon Martin. Kenyon, welcome back.
What's that, sir?
You were a teammate of Carmelo's both in Denver and in New York. How should he handle this situation?
I think it's time for Melo to speak up. He's taking the high road as much as he can now. You know, after these latest statements, how can you not speak up for yourself?
Right.
You know, that's my whole thing. He's went out there and played and not said anything and just let Phil continuously throughout the season, whether it's directly or indirectly, voice his opinions or statements.
Take shots at him,
which he say he didn't. Let's be honest. We know where it's coming from. But, yeah, I honestly think it's time for Melo to speak up for himself.
Here's the thing. Since when is holding the ball as an NBA basketball player not viewed as a criticism? Oh, that's true. That's just fact. That's just what he does. Okay, just because that's what he does, you're criticizing. And you're talking about if you can't accept coaching. Phil, newsflash, you're not the coach.
Exactly.
If you were on the sidelines, if you were coaching Carmelo Anthony and you had this criticism, have at it.
Okay.
You're upstairs. Since Phil has gotten there, they're 80-166. Phil put this together.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You gave Carmelo, not only did you give him the max, now Carmelo took $5 million less than the max, but you also gave him a no-trade clause. Here's the thing what people don't know. Carmelo has one more year, and he has an option. Mm-hmm. So if I'm Carmelo, this is how I'm going to do Phil. I'm going to hit him like this here. You know, they signed Phil picked up the two-year option. Picked up mine, too.
Yeah, I'm with you.
I ain't going nowhere because guess what?
I'm with him.
I did everything I possibly could. He could have gone to New York at the end of the season. He wanted to trade. He wanted to get there in a hurry. Now, in order for the Knicks to sign Carmelo, they had to empty their cupboards. So when he got there, Carmelo was the only ingredient. He didn't realize this. But they did go to the playoffs before Phil got there. Now, all of a sudden, Phil can't draft. He can't sign anybody. Oh, everybody want to play for New York. Everybody want to play for Phil Jackson. No, they don't. They want to play for Phil if he's coaching. But I'm not going. If I'm Carmelo Anthony, I'm not going nowhere. Hey, Jennifer Holliday? Was it Jennifer? I'm not going nowhere. And you going to love me, Phil, because I'm not going.
I'm with him.
We're a package deal.
Yes.
I'm not with him on this, but I'm for him. And here's why.
Okay.
Carmelo Anthony is now almost 33 years of age. Mm-hmm. He's played 14 full years in the National Basketball Association, and you were with him a bunch of those years. He does not have much to show for it in the way of postseason, right?
Yeah.
You guys got to the conference finals in Denver one time, and that's as close as he got. And I can't remember what happened in that series. Did you?
We threw the ball away twice. Yeah. Out of bounds plays. Went out of bounds plays.
Okay, I got you.
Trying to get the ball to Melo, like Paul George.
Uh-huh.
Those types of situations.
Yeah.
They were trying to force the ball to the bench. Go ahead.
I was a corporate, but yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Okay. So if I'm Carmelo now, I embrace what Phil is saying because I want out. I don't want to be part of this mess. I don't care how much I make. I make $25 million the next 2 years. Who cares? What, don't you want to chase a championship one time in your life? So if he will give you away and your contract intact to the Clippers or the Celtics or the Cavaliers, whoever it might be, I don't know who it might be. Clippers are probably the best destination for him at this point. Why wouldn't you embrace that and say, thank you for letting me out? Why wouldn't you say, I waive my no trade because I want to jump at a chance to go someplace to win one championship or at least go deep in the playoffs? They're not going to be a playoff team the next 2 years the way they're heading, right? I don't see any sign of life.
The Clippers might not be in existence by the time he gets there. Yeah. They might blow that up if they don't.
Wherever is the best place for him to fit.
Yeah.
Whoever will take on $25 million Carmelo dollars, and I don't know, they might ask him to renegotiate.
The best place is New York.
Okay.
The best place is New York for him where he already is. You get rid of, like you said, I'm sticking it out. I'm not waving my no trade clause because Phil Jackson. No.
Okay.
You so build this team around Porzingis and myself.
Okay, but out
let's
of
get
spite,
it done.
You're just going to
yes!
stick
yes!
out of spite.
That's what, that's what Phil is doing.
Okay, but you know what's going to happen? He's going to wind up 35 years of age, and nobody's going to want him, and he's going to be without even close to a championship.
It happens. Yeah. It happens sometimes. Yeah. There have been a lot of great players.
Great.
Patrick Ewing, Karl Malone, Charles Barkley, Elgin Baylor. There are a lot of great players that don't have rings.
Yeah, I like Carmelo. I know Carmelo, but he has become the ultimate entrepreneur in in New York City.
Yep. Yeah.
And all of a sudden, he's got so many business deals off the field, so to speak, off the court through the offseason.
Yep.
I don't think he wants to leave New York because he's got a whole nother life outside
That's
of basketball.
Right.
He can still live there no matter where he plays. He can still have those same business adventures and do whatever he's doing.
Right.
That man want to win. That man want to win there.
He wouldn't have signed back there if he wouldn't have. But if the other, if Phil is running the show, what are the odds they're going to win in the next 2 years?
Yeah. Phil was running the show and signed him to a five-year max deal.
Okay,
he was running the show and gave him a no-trade clause.
That was Phil's mistake, and he's asking Carmelo to undo Phil's mistake.
Nope, I ain't going to do it. I'm not going to help. After all you've said about me negative,
this out.
And you want me to help you?
That's classic what you call cutting off your nose to spite your face. You're saying, I'm going to stick it back to you. I'm sticking it out.
My sense
and you're going where? Nowhere.
Skip, my sense of smell is not very good, so I don't really need a nose. So you're exactly right. Yeah, I'm going to cut it off. And if I can't hear what you said, I'll cut my ears off too. I'm not going.
Okay. He's going to be branded at the end of his career an underachieving loser. That's how people view him now.
They're going to say that Carmelo Anthony ain't win no ring. Yeah. That $250 million habit in the bank, Carmelo Anthony, I don't care what they call me.
It's an unfortunate situation, man, that he cares as much as he does. And
exactly. And you try to use that against him.
Yeah, and it gets displayed in a negative light, you know what I'm saying, coming from somebody that's
You're just trying to run him out of town?
Yes! Yeah,
and I wouldn't let you.
Okay.
It's pride involves in this.
Okay,
I would not let you do that.
The interesting thing is that Phil doesn't think that he is taking jabs at Carmelo while trying to run him out of town. It's like, is he loving him out of town? I don't know. I don't get it.
No mercy. The Warriors used a 15-2 fourth quarter run to beat the Blazers yesterday. Kevin Durant had 32, Steph Curry added 29, and Draymond Green had a great game with nearly a triple-double and five blocks. After the game, Steve Kerr praised Draymond's performance. Let's take a listen.
Draymond was amazing. He made some tremendous defensive plays. He made threes. He rebounded the ball. He had nine assists. I mean, he played a game that, I'm not sure anybody else in the league is capable of, honestly. Who else can do what Draymond just did tonight? He's so unique and so important to us, and he was phenomenal.
We just started to really rotate. We stopped letting Damian and CJ get downhill, made them take tough shots. I think they had, 47, 48 points at halftime? It's hard to win like that, so once we start scrambling around, stopping them two, it all clicked. I'm our ultimate help man at all times, so I tend to sink off a bit. And, we have two guys on Damian and CJ at all times, so I can come weak side and they don't see me. I sneak in there and get a couple blocks.
Skip, how impressive was Golden State yesterday?
Before you go, Skip, Steve Kerr, you need to get an apology card and send it to one LeBron James, because that's a guy that can do everything and a little bit more than what Draymond did. Because if you remember, Skip, he's the only man to lead a series in every statistical category. So blocks, rebound, assists, steals. LeBron James did it. Carry on, Skip.
Wait, you mean the same LeBron?
Skip!
Wait. He chose not to guard Paul George on the last sequence on Saturday? That guy?
You want to go ahead, Skip, with your point?
Well, I was trying until I got rudely interrupted.
Okay, go ahead.
Here we go. I Ask me again, Joy.
How impressive was Golden State yesterday?
Yeah,
I was not very impressed because this is a mismatch. This is going to be a sweep. We all know Portland has two extraordinary shot-making guards. One is 6'3", and the other is 6'3". And that is just about all that Portland has.
Yeah.
So in the first half, Damian, C.J. McCollum, they combined to go 17 of 26 yesterday. And guess what the halftime score was? It was tied at 56-56. And in the second half, Dame and C.J. combined to go only 11 for 28, which is more business as usual. They go only 2 for 7 from three because Golden State started to lock them up out at the three-point line, as well as not letting them get downhill, as Draymond just said. And Golden State won the second half 65-53, and they won the game easily by 12 points. Portland obviously has two extraordinary guards, but wait a second. They're not even as good as Golden State's two guards. Are they better than Steph and Klay? I think I'll take Steph and Klay.
They are, but they're better. I think they're better scorers. They can score the ball.
Hey, if you took Steph and Klay out and put them in Portland by themselves with what Portland has, they would light it up just like these two do, but they wouldn't win.
I don't think they can get down here. These guys, I mean, if you notice, Klay don't really dribble
the
ball.
No, he doesn't, but
Steph
again,
can get to the rack.
Okay, but Steph can get the rack.
Yeah.
But here's the point, that Portland, okay, say that's a push with two versus two, but all of a sudden, here's Kevin Durant, who looked pretty much like Kevin Durant. He goes 32-10 yesterday. They were looking at his knee a couple times on the sideline, but it may have been just adjusting the brace or I don't know, but he looked like he was 1,000% to me.
Yep.
And then, obviously, Portland does not have a Draymond Green, who, to Steve Kerr's point, yesterday had 19 points, 12 rebounds, 9 assists, 5 blocks, and 3 steals. I mean, it's just, I'm not sure even the King could do that now at his advanced age.
Sure.
At his advanced age, because he's played 14 years and he's like 38 or what is he? I lose track.
You saw what he did in game 7. Do I need to refresh your memory about these stats?
I saw Kyrie win it with the last second shot.
Stop it.
But here's the point. I'm going to say this one more time. All that said about Golden State's dominance, if Yusef Nurkic were able to play in this series, it would be very different. And to Draymond's credit, he said just before the series started, they are a very different team with Nurkic. He is a 7-foot, 22-year-old emerging star who fractured his fibula about 3 weeks ago.
Right.
And everybody kept saying he's going to try to play. I think they were just jacking with the psyche of Golden State.
Yes.
Trying to make them get ready to play Nurkic. I don't think he's going to be seen in this series because I just don't know how you come back from a fractured fibula that fast, but maybe I'm wrong. I hope he heals just for the sake of a little drama, but it looks doubtful to me. And that's why yesterday, I must say this, as much as I admire Draymond's game, it gets a little hard to stomach to watch him continue to trash talk and gloat and showboat when there's no Nurkic because he goes up and he swats Vonley's dunk attempt. Okay, big deal. And then he swats Damian's shot at the rim.
Damian was about to dunk on Kevin Durant.
But he's not going to pull that off. I'm sorry. That's not a big deal in either case. And Draymond gives it one of these, big deal. You know, just stop it. Wait until you play a real team. If Nurkic were in there, I'd say you can flex.
Real
Go ahead
team?
And flex.
Or you play somebody like that freight train that comes down the lane.
Yeah, that team. Play a real team.
At 6'8" and a half, 250.
Well, I'll give you that on that one. Yeah, if you want to flex against LeBron, I'm okay with that.
Oh, you
want to? Well, he's got no respect for LeBron in the first place.
Oh,
right?
he got the ultimate respect for the
King.
Oh, does
he? Because he called him the B word in the middle of a game last year when it looked like they were about to go up. They were
up. He called him a boss.
A boss?
He called him a boss.
Kind of a word like boss.
Yeah, he called him a boss. Did he enjoy
it? Except it was more
73-9. Say how you like.
I think you have to add another letter in there and maybe change some.
He said, Draymond, catch me at the parade. How about that?
He did?
Yeah.
And he did.
Skip. The Warriors put so much pressure on you offensively and defensively because you know there are very few teams. I mean, there are a couple of teams, Skip, that if they get hot, they can give you 30, 35 points in a quarter. The Warriors can do it for 4 quarters. No other team can give you 30 points a quarter for 4 times. They can do that. The problem that the Trailblazers give you that forces the Warriors because they can't hide Steph Curry. Because, okay, Klay normally takes the best point guard or the best two guard, and then Steph gets to fiddle around. Well, he either has to guard Dame Lillard or he has to guard C.J. McCollum. So who does he slack up on? And that's what happens. He was getting downhill as Draymond, they were getting downhill because either both guys can finish at the rack with either hand. And then if you don't push up on them, they're going to let the three go. Dame Lillard was shooting a couple of those threes from San Francisco from way, way, way out, Skip. I mean, he has unbelievable range. But here lies the problem. If they do not have Kevin Durant, the Warriors would have lost this game. Harrison Barnes not giving you 32 points yesterday.
He's not.
Kevin Durant is so efficient. He's 12 of 20. He gave you 30.
I was shocked at the end of the game because I lost track of his total. I looked at the box. I thought, he got 32. When did that happen?
32. Whew. And he's so efficient. Yep. But here's the problem that they possess. Okay, KD and Steph, CJ and Dame, they cancel out. What you going to do about Draymond's 19? What you going to do about Klay Thompson, who had a terrible game shooting the ball, 15? And then Ian Clark gave you 12 points in 12 minutes.
He was just lighting it up.
So now you get, I mean, Evan Turner had 10, Mo Harkless had 11, and then you got two from Vonleh. Mm-hmm. Aminu gave you nothing. Krabs gave you three. Shabazz Napier gave you three. Myles Leonard gave you zero. Skip, how do you beat a team with four All-Stars, four All-NBA players, when you get two guys going for 75, mm-hmm. but the other eight guys go for 34? Mm. You're not winning. Mm. You're not beating that team. Now, I do believe that when they go home, they'll get one game. I don't believe they'll get swept because CJ and Dame will continue to go crazy because they really have no answer to it, Skip. You just got to hope they miss. But they need more from the starters.
You know what? The more I think about that concept of if you switch Steph and Klay and put them in Portland, now there have to be no Nurkic.
Right.
If it's just the same team in Portland, they would be better than these two would be.
You think so?
Yeah, Klay can get to the rim on his own.
Yeah.
He can. He can also get in the lane and go. He's 6'7". He'll just go up and shoot little jump shot floaters, you know. I think they would score just as – if that's what they wanted to do, just light it up, shoot, you know, 30 shots a game each, I think they could be better than these two.
But they got – but see, that – and it's hard. I mean, think about it. They subtract Harrison Barnes, and they add the second or third best player in the NBA to their roster. Obviously.
On paper and on the floor yesterday, it was unfair.
If they have Harrison Barnes, if this is Harrison Barnes,
No, I agree.
The Warriors are not winning this game. Mm-hmm. They're not.
Okay, but I'm going to stand by what I say. If you can get them in a late game, close game situation, they're not sure who's going
to
do it.
Who's been able to do it? Who's been able to do that?
Well, is it Kevin's team or is it Steph's team?
Who's been able to take them out to that deep, Skip? You remember on Christmas?
This is not about LeBron. Game two is Wednesday night in Oracle. And after the game.
By the way, since he brought up LeBron, I was thinking about LeBron yesterday sitting watching these games. And every other commercial was a new Steph Curry commercial, national TV ad. And I'm thinking, LeBron has to be sitting in his big pad. Is he in Akron?
Yeah, he's in Akron.
Akron, King
of Akron. Did that 35,000 square foot.
He has to be sitting there thinking, am I old news? I mean, this guy's taking over, right? Don't you think he would think that?
Got an IMAX. Huh? Like you go to the movie and watch IMAX. Yeah. LeBron got one of them in his basement.
Because he's a basketball junkie now. He's going to watch all these games. He's going to see Steph, commercial, Steph, commercial, Steph, commercial. Where's my commercial?
And he's looking like, I own KD, I own Klay, I own Steph, I own Draymond.
Really?
Yeah, what are you saying? No
mercy. This is the Skip and Shannon Undisputed Podcast, where we're delivering you an unscripted, unfiltered, undisputed version of the biggest topics of the day's show. Be sure to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, like us on Facebook at Undisputed on FS1, follow on Twitter at Undisputed, and catch us at 9:30 a.m. Eastern, 6:30 Pacific, Monday through Friday on FS1. You can find us on Channel 219 on DirecTV, 150 on Dish. Thanks for listening, everybody. I'm your host, Joy Taylor. That's it for us today. We come back tomorrow for more debates. Stay with us all week as we welcome Lil Wayne, Morris Chestnut, and Nelly to the desk this week. We'll talk to you on Tuesday.
Facts, sports, one of one.